Hi, everybody, brothers and sisters. I hope you're having a great day. I am. I'm having a great day. It's a beautiful day in Atlanta. Went to Bible study this morning. My friend Ferry, she had been really busy at home with her son studying and everything. And this morning, and it's just so amazing. She's like, God spoke to me. You know, God had spoken to her in dreams and visions before, but since she's gotten baptized, she's developing a conversational relationship with him, and she's like, this is so cool. So she was like, please forgive me, God. I don't want to go to Bible study today. And he said something about, you have 1 hour or 1 day to give me glory. So she said, okay. And she got ready and she came to Bible study. We're studying, and if you want to go to it, we're studying Romans. And Romans 3, I guess it was the second half of Romans 3, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That all means all, even though we think that we are good people, we still sin, and all have sinned, and all have fallen short of the glory of God. And praying, you know, that is a complicated thing, but it is a totally free gift. It's a free gift, but it is a gift that we must receive and take action on. She used an example about a rope, and I'll give an example that is a little bit different from hers, but still one that I've heard before. You know, you can be paddling along, canoeing along in your boat or your kayak down a very peaceful river and thinking, wow, it's a beautiful day, peaceful river, and what are those people yelling at me on the shore? What are they yelling at me for? And it's because the people on the shore know that what you think is a peaceful, beautiful river ends in Niagara Falls. You're going to be plunging to your death at the waterfall. And so what they're doing is they're yelling at you, take the life preserver, and they're throwing you a rope with a life preserver on it, and they're telling you to get out of the boat and grab onto it. But you think life is wonderful, so you don't listen and you don't grab onto it. It's the same kind of thing. God knows that you will perish without Jesus, and Jesus is your life preserver. And so you're in the boat thinking everything's going great, but he's throwing, you know, the people are saying, repent, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. And they're throwing Jesus out to you as a life preserver, but you have to grab hold of it. That's why faith is something that is a gift from God. You know, Abraham was counted righteous, but in Hebrews 11, all those people, the hall of fame of faith, all of those people were chosen by God to be given faith, but they had to take an action to trust in him. Way of the master, the way they talk about it is that there could be two people on an airplane and they know that they have a parachute, and they know the parachute's under their seat, and the flight gets kind of bumpy, and it looks like the flight attendants are nervous and all of that, and so they pick it and put the parachute on their laps, and then the flight attendant comes and says, the plane is going down, you're going to have to jump. Well, the person who actually has put on the parachute, the salvation, the trust in the parachute, those are the ones who will survive the fall. But those who didn't actually, they're like, I know what a parachute is. I know the parachute can save my life, but they won't put it on. They don't get saved from the fall that is to come. So go into Romans 3. It's got the gospel. We also talked about Romans 10. If you confess with your mouth, I think it's 10:9. If you confess with your mouth and believe that Jesus is Lord, that you will be saved. So it's not just believing in Jesus, it's confessing him as Lord. And we were talking about, what is the importance of actually speaking out that Jesus is Lord? I think it's because it's a way to fight the spiritual battle. If we speak out, if we're speaking out loud Jesus' name, there's power in Jesus' name. If we are confessing that Jesus is Lord, I think evil spirits that are trying to oppress us and to bring us down, that they have to leave. And that God created by speaking creation into existence. So I think there is a lot to be said for speaking it out. And people may say, well, I don't want to be, speaking out, Jesus is Lord as I'm walking around my house. But I'd say, go get in your car. Go get in your car and attack the enemy, in the car, and say, Jesus is Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, Satan, get away from me. You have no dominion over me. You have no authority over me. I am under the authority of Jesus Christ. Also, we had in our Bible study a verse that I really like. It's Philippians 2:13. It's something I used to have it memorized. It's if Philippians 2:13, God is working in you, giving you the power to obey him and do what pleases him. Our obedience, we cannot do it on our own. Our obedience is also a gift from God. Everything is a gift from God. Our faith is a gift from God. Our obedience is a gift from God. But when we have faith, we want to obey. We want to do what pleases God, which is what Philippians 2:13 is about. So if you think about it, God has made us as his appliances. We've got some work to do, right? So say I'm a refrigerator, for instance. My responsibility is to keep the food fresh and keep it cold, right? But I can't fulfill my responsibility and what God has made me to be if I'm not plugged into the electric power. If I'm not plugged into the power, I cannot fulfill the job that I am supposed to do as a refrigerator. If I'm not plugged into the power of the Holy Spirit, I cannot do the job that God has made me to do in the body. That has nothing to do with whether I've received salvation. It's that once I've received salvation through nothing that I did on my own, then God wants to grow me and teach me and have me use the things that he gives me to be able to have the same, to do what he wants me to do in the body. So look at Philippians 2:13. I know I didn't have it down word for word. This morning, I'm going tonight to go see Kirk Cameron's Revive Us 2, I think it is. I went to the first one about a year ago. Whoa, four male bluebirds just flew off. Ooh, they're so beautiful. I'm going to the Revive Us. Okay, so talking about some rapture dates possibility. Fairy asked me, are there some other dates you're thinking of? And I was like, yes, and I still don't understand. I don't understand. There's a lot of, we don't understand things. I don't understand why, if I ask God, are you coming before October 21st? And I open up to 1 Kings 11, then I ask him the same question. I open up to Matthew 5, and then I ask him the same question. And I open up to 1 Kings 11, and then I ask him the same question. I open up to Matthew 5. I don't understand why that doesn't mean that he would be here by October 21st, but obviously he's not. We're still here. I made it through a valley, and won a spiritual battle. not by my own power, but by the power of God's grace in my life. So I have on my calendar the next high watch date is October 26th, this Thursday, and that is because if the full moon is the Gentile beginning of things, the full moon is the Gentile moon. I think some people say that's the Creator moon calendar. I haven't looked at that calendar, but I think that's right. Then this Thursday, the 26th, would be the end of Tabernacles, the eighth day, that something Shemitah or whatever. And then, of course, the following week, we have a lot of things pointing to October 30th, Halloween, November 2nd. I don't think there's that much on November 1st. Maybe All Saints Day is on November 1st. November 2nd, which is the 100th anniversary of the Balfour Declaration, I think. November 3rd, which is my birthday and also has a lot of other possibilities. But, you know, one day at a time, right? But it was funny, as I was driving home, and the traffic was pretty bad at 3 o'clock, 3:15 in Atlanta. It was bad. And there was this big truck, not like a semi tractor trailer thing, something that looked like it was maybe a truck that carries stuff from garbage dumpsters or something. And it has one number on the back of it, very large, T, T as in Terry, T-726. Those of us who are watchers, we know 726 is Harpazo, right? Then I was going to try to take a picture of it, but I never could get in position where it wouldn't be, you know, at a light, for instance, or where the traffic had stopped, where I could get a picture of it. Then when I went past it, the truck in front of it had 1031. It didn't say Halloween, but it had 1031. Then I go to make a turn to head towards home, and I go in front of a high school, and all the buses are coming out of the high school, and the bus in front of me is 2726. So could I take that to mean that God is giving me another high watch day? I mean, October 30th is Yom Kippur. That's a possibility. It's the Yom Kippur based on the new moon sighting, which was in Jerusalem. It was on 10/21, the day of my son's wedding. But the funny thing was, it was sighted in North Carolina, that first sliver of the moon with the two witnesses. It was sighted in North Carolina and some other place in the Eastern Standard or Eastern Daylight Time before it was sighted the next day in Jerusalem. But anyway, October 30th would be Yom Kippur based on the 21st of the new moon sighting. So anyway, of the numbers that I saw, it was like, oh, Harpazo, oh, Halloween, oh, Harpazo. Don't know what that means. This morning I woke up with the song, and I thought, oh, this is a Mercy Me song, and it's not. It's Chris Tomlin's Greater, and this is the song, Greater is the One Who Lives in Me. Let's see. Chris Tomlin, Greater. Huh. Greater is the one who lives in me. Greater is the love of Jesus. I don't know why it's not playing. Oh, there we go. There is the one who lives in me. Greater is the love of Jesus. Greater than my sin, greater than the grave, above all other thrones, above all other names. Greater, you are greater.
To God be the glory. Above all other thrones, above all other names, greater.
Okay, I'm going to stop it because I have found that, I don't know if this is what's going on, but YouTube blocks some of my videos in other countries. I know Michael, my friend in the UK, has brought this to my attention. I don't know if it's because they're watching the video and they see that I'm using a clip of someone else's video. I don't know. So look that song up, and then the other song that was a song I was singing on the way to Bible study. And then on the way home, I was singing a song by Johnson Ferry Worship, Always Only Jesus. It's like, let it be always only Jesus. In everything my heart will sing, let it be always only Jesus. Now, the thing about it, when God gives me a song, it's almost always just a piece of a lyric of a song. So for him, you know, I didn't sing this whole song this morning. I just kept singing. It's like this continual loop that'll be going on. I just kept singing, greater is the one who lives in me. Greater is the love of Jesus. I just kept singing that over and over and over again. Then on my way home, it's, let it be always only Jesus. So I don't know if he speaks to y'all in the same way that he speaks to me, but that is definitely one of the ways he speaks to me. Then, you know, he speaks in numbers on cars. He speaks in so many different ways. And I just hope that we'll continue to keep listening and looking for the ways that he speaks. And I hope that you'll be encouraged to go to the Bible and read the primary way that he speaks to us. You know, read Romans, read Philippians. Philippians actually is the book of joy. So I love y'all. Talk to you later. Bye.